I think a lot of people have in their minds, at least in the context of breast cancer, many women think about risk factors being genetic. Mm-hmm. You know, there are certain gene polymorphisms, which are variations in the sequence of DNA that alter the function somewhat, that can put a woman at risk, particularly genes that are involved in repairing DNA damage, specifically in the breast tissue.
Right.
BRCA1, BRCA2, I think many people are familiar with these genes. But really what your research and what a lot of research out there has shown is that there are lifestyle factors that play a, if not equally important role, and certainly in combination with these genetic risk factors would really be very, very important in modifying breast cancer risk. And not only risk, but recurrence. So there are a few types of lifestyle factors that we talked about today that may, you know, dramatically lower a female's breast cancer risk, and also people out, women out there that have had breast cancer, certain lifestyles they should adopt in order to lower their recurrence.
Right.
So what do you, if you want to talk about maybe the top ones?
Sure. BRCA1 and 2, if you have that gene, you know, polymorphism, that's a pretty special case. And those women are at very high risk of breast cancer and recurrence. And it's hard to know for that small percentage of women how much lifestyle matters. But again, they're a special case. Majority of cancers are just sporadic. We think that less than 5% overall of breast cancers are the result of genetic factors. Mm-hmm. And more like 65 to 75% are the result of lifestyle factors, including obesity, diet, physical activity, and smoking. And alcohol, we think, maybe, for breast cancer. So those are all things you can modify. So the idea that you're doomed by your genetics couldn't be more wrong. For the vast majority of women, it is your lifestyle choices that will make the biggest difference in your risk, which is not the same thing as saying you're to blame, because a lot of cancers are sporadic, but that there are things you can do to reduce your personal risk a lot.
Well, that's good news.
Yeah.
So don't smoke, moderate drink, don't drink a lot. Lose weight.
And even a small amount of weight. Recently, there was a study that seemed to show, like, they saw huge improvements in metabolic health in the first 5% of weight loss. And then they said if you looked at 5 to 10% of weight loss, it's like it flattened out. There wasn't, you know, it isn't like a linear thing. So it looks like even modest weight loss can really improve your metabolic health. So I think there's this perception that, well, if I don't get to model skinny, there's no point in even trying. And I think that's a really wrong way of looking at weight loss. 5% weight loss could really make a difference.
5% of your...
5% and keep it, you know, keep it off. You know, and maybe in a year or two, you might go, well, maybe I'll lose another 5%. You know, but the idea that there's like some very linear thing going on, I'm not sure the data really support that. So even modest weight loss, you know, work on the quality of your diet, work on the time of your diet, get some physical activity, please. You know, avoid long periods of sedentary behavior. All those things combined, good sleep, you know, and good food choices, I think that's the total combination of things is the best thing you can work toward. And just make it a lifestyle to always be working on improving those things as your whole life.
I think that's fantastic advice. And I just want to mention that number again, because it really is, you know, the best. Obviously, no one wants cancer. Right. You know, that if you can do whatever you can within your, you know, control to give yourself the best possible chance of not getting cancer,
right,
then really, 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 you should do it. That's, you know.
And there's a super benefit here, is that it likely will reduce your risk of cardiovascular disease, which, after all, is still the number one killer of women. So, you know, you're really getting a 360 effect on your risk of all the major killers in America, some unpleasant conditions like diabetes, and also hopefully just feeling better every day.
Absolutely.
Right. And that's, quality of life, basic quality of life. Right.
I think there's been studies showing like weight loss improves mood, you know, inflammations associated with depression, you know, and inflammations associated with obesity. So yeah, you're right. All these things, your
physical activity is associated with reduced risk of depression or ameliorating some of the effects. So there's, you know, it's not like there's a separate list of things you should do for one disease versus another. It's like the total benefit package.
Yeah, they're all overlapping.
Much more overlapping. We used to not think that as much. We used to think they were completely disease. Here's the disease pathway for cardiovascular disease. It's very metabolic. It's blood pressure. It's cholesterol. And here's cancer. And it's a genetic disease. And they're two separate pathways. Now we see that they're actually way more overlapping than we ever knew. And it's really good news because it means you don't have to do separate things for each disease. It means the same suite of healthful behaviors can give you 360 protection.
Well said.